Hey kids, Mr. Fly here, hope you're well. Now, it's the end of March already, would you believe? Which means it's time for us to take our look back at the month's motorcycling news, courtesy of MCN. Now, because of the way the month has fallen this month, there are actually five issues, because there were five Wednesdays, which is when the paper comes out. So stick around, stay tuned for the next few minutes, and I'll show you some of the stories that have piqued my interest this month. Okay, so to the first paper then, and what I've tried to do, I've been quite ruthless, because there are five to get through here. So we'll go through them fairly quickly. First story that just took my interest here is this Hesketh's new beast is the headline. And this is yet another of these bikes that is just stupidly expensive. I'm really glad though that these manufacturers exist to come up with these bikes because they're just daft, aren't they? So the Hesketh, for example, it's got 210 brake horsepower. It's supercharged. It's got 217 foot-pounds of torque. It's got this massive air-cooled 2.1-litre engine, which I think is an American engine. Absolutely stonking bike. What it rides like, goodness knows. But the point is, it's £50,000 if you want to buy one. So there ain't going to be too many people that are buying them. But it has got something about it, I must admit. It does look the business. I'd love to have a go on one. It must be absolutely ballistic when you're on it. But anyway, just thought I'd point that out because it's just such an amazing-looking bike. Okay, next story. While we're getting our way to the next story, look at that. Cole Fogarty, say no more. Okay, next, moving swiftly on. Oh yeah, okay, here we are. Now, this month, actually, MCN and myself seem to have been quite in sync with some of the stories that we've covered. I think that's more by chance than judgment. But here we go. So this particular story is all about Chinese bikes made in Britain. So this is highlighting Herald. Now, you may have seen a video I did a few weeks back on the Mutt Mongrel, which is on a similar sort of vein. It's a bike that actually, in the case of the Mutt Mongrel, it's actually built in the UK out of Chinese parts. In the case of these, the 250 Heralds, they're actually importing Chinese bikes and then changing them into these sort of custom-like bikes. So it's just a slightly different approach. So what they're doing is things like putting in good quality spark plugs, changing the fluids, changing the suspension, and basically anything that they think is substandard on the Chinese bike, they're replacing, giving it this great custom look and then selling them on. They're about £3,500 for a brand new 250. So I think it's great. I know a lot of people are anti-Chinese bikes, but I just think it's really good that companies are giving this a go. And if you're new into motorcycling, this gives you a great entry with a brand new bike and they just look great. I have to say all the people that have fed back to my Mutt review that I did have said what great fun they've had on the bikes and how reliable they've proven to be. So I haven't got anything bad to say about them. I think they're great and good luck to Herald. Okay, so that's that. And then the final story I picked out from this first issue is here. Now this is just tucked in at the bottom here. This is a thing that MCN are doing this month, or the next few months actually. It's basically trying to encourage people to ride 5,000 miles in a year. So the reason I mention this is because it got me thinking, hey, now how many miles does the average biker do? I'm quite lucky because, obviously I've got several bikes. But over all my bikes, I think I'm doing about at least 7,000 miles a year. And I don't even have to commute or anything. I work from home. So there must be an awful lot of bikers out there that don't do many miles. So I'd just be interested to hear how many miles you do a year. And maybe it's, people that watch these sort of videos, you and I, we're enthusiasts, so we do a lot of miles, so it might be irrelevant, but clearly there are a lot of bikers out there that don't do that many miles. Anyway, so that's a little initiative they've got to try and get people out on the bike more, which has got to be a good thing. Okay, next paper. Just a few stories here again. First one, this is an example of where myself and MCN seem to have been in sync, because I rode this. This is the BMW Racer, the retro racer. I rode this a couple of weeks ago, and it's an absolutely gorgeous looking bike. It really surprised me, because I didn't think I'd like it very much, because being a boxer owner myself, I know that they're not really sports engines, but just in this configuration with that retro looking cowling, the bike is just really lovely. It's well made. It looks much better in the flesh, I have to say, than it does on the pictures. And for 10,000 quid, I just think it's excellent value. And I'm pleased to say the summary that MCN came to was much the same as mine, that it's excellent value, it's well built. It's a very different ride in terms of the riding position you're on and so on. So if you think you don't like that sort of bike, which is what I thought, I do encourage you, if you're near a BMW dealer, pop down there, have a look at it in the flesh. I think you might be surprised. So that's the Racer. Next little story here, just tucked in at the bottom here. Record Breakers is the headline. I just want to point this out because this is just one of those nut stories again. This is a guy, Carl Rees, who's recently broken the Guinness World Record for the greatest distance ridden on a motorcycle in 24 hours. Now, would you believe he did 2,119 miles in 24 hours, and that was at an average of 92 miles per hour. Incredible. Can you imagine that? 24 hours at 92 miles an hour. In fact, you topped out at 141 miles an hour at one point. So, well, I mean, it must be a great honour to be in the Guinness Book of World Records, but you've got to really want to be in it to do that sort of thing, haven't you? Think of the state of his backside when he finished. Anyway, there we go. That's that. Less said about that, the better. Next story picked out, again, another example of where myself and MCN are in sync. This is a story about, or it's the first review that MCN have done of the KTM Super Adventure R. Now, this is the off-road version of the Super Adventure. I've been lucky enough in recent weeks to ride the T, which is the touring version, and a couple of weeks ago, I rode the S, which I just absolutely loved. It was an amazing bike. Well, this, as I say, is the off-road version. Much the same as the other bikes, except it's got spoked wheels, which are favoured by off-road types, and it's got this little dinky screen. Which I just wonder about. This little dinky screen is also on the BMW GS Rally. It's obviously something that that the manufacturers think off-roaders like, but I just can't help but wonder, how effective is that? One, I don't think it looks very good. I think the bigger screen actually looks better. But also, that can't actually do much, can it? So, anyway, there we go. But an amazing bike, I'm sure. If it's anything like the other Super Adventures, then, you know, I'll forgive it the little screen. Simply, you know, simply replaced, after all. Okay, and then last but not least in this edition, what have we got here? Oh yeah, this is an interesting story that slightly alarming. This is called Beat the Rise, and this is talking about an increase, a likely increase in insurance premiums very soon for bikes. Now, again, if you've been watching my channel, you'll know that I'm not a big fan of bike insurance. It's can be an absolute nightmare out there. Again, I did a little video about insurance, and it was a bit of a rant actually, and it was incredible the number of comments I got and the number of horror stories I heard about some of the things people have to put up with from their insurance companies is amazing. I must say, they're not all bad. I did have some insurance companies contact me, actually, and so I might be doing some more work with those in the future to kind of put their case for. But anyway, at this moment, I'm still anti-insurance. But anyway, the point of this story is there is a rise coming, because apparently something called the Ogden rate has been revised. And this is the thing that the courts use to work out big payouts. If there's a big insurance claim made, then they use this thing called the Ogden rate to factor a fair payment. So this Ogden rate, because of the changes in interest rates, or the historically low interest rates we've been having of late, means that they're gonna have to revise the Ogden rate, which will have the effect of putting all our insurance premiums up. So something to look forward to there, not. Okay, so that was that one. Next, we get in there. Next, okay, what's this? Oh yeah, just a very quick point. This is a big article actually in this edition, all about John McGuinness and in particular Guy Martin, who of course is now riding the new Fireblade in the TT. I thought it was interesting to note that they've been practicing together to kind of tweak how they work with the team, which is great. Apparently that's all going very, very well. But what I thought was interesting is they get ready for the TT, they actually go to Spain and race on a track as opposed to a road circuit. So anyway, I just thought that was interesting. Moving on swiftly. Now this is a heck of a story. John Surtees, what a man. It's just great to think back on his accomplishments. Very sadly, last month or this month, he died. But he reached a ripe old age. I can't remember how old he was actually. I think he was in his 80s, so he did pretty well. But the point is, he's the only man ever to have won motorcycle world championships and Grand Prix car world championships. In fact, I think it was in 1955 that he won. Yeah, 1955, he actually, entered 72 races and won 65 of them. What an incredible thing to do. And then I think it was, I can't remember what date it was that he won the world championship in the cars. I'll find out, here we are. 1964, he was Formula One world champion. And he'd already got 7 world championship titles on bikes by then. What an incredible achievement. And the guy was never given, was never made sir. So, I mean, that is, that's a bit shocking really, isn't it? But that's the achievement that surely will never be beaten again, because just, you know, cars and bikes are now so diverged. I just don't think you're going to get that sort of talent. But whenever I saw him on the TV and interviews and things, he seems a really nice chap. Really sad that he's gone, but thought mentioning it worth mentioning him, of course, because of that amazing achievement. Oh, here we go, another bike that where I'm in sync with MCN, because I rode this bike as well a couple of weeks ago. This is the BMW S1000R. This actually is the sport version. I think I rode the standard one. This is an amazing naked bike. It's got loads of go, but for me, it's just maybe a little bit too clinical. And the thing that really I can't get on with this is this squinty front end. I just think it looks horrible and puts me off the bike entirely. And having ridden before I rode this, the KTM Super Duke R, I have to say the Super Duke R for me was just a much nicer bike. It was much more grin inducing. There's just something about that KTM that is just awesome. There's nothing wrong at all with the BMW. It may be that it's just a bit too perfect, other than that squinty front end. But interesting, again, I thought that MCN had done the review on that at the same time as I'd done my review or uploaded it. And then last store in here, just to pick out of this particular issue, was I was surprised to see in the small print here on the sort of buying and selling section that actually Triumph have announced that they've discontinued production of the 1200 Trophy, which I think it happened a little while ago. It's the first I'd heard of it. And clearly it hadn't been selling very much. So it's a bit sad when any bike is taken out of production, isn't it? But the Trophy, when I rode it, I have to say, did feel very heavy and not a patch on the BMW RT, which it blatantly was sort of a copy of. I think Triumph do best when they do, you know, they don't try and copy others, but they do their own thing. I mean, we know they're great at doing the retro stuff at the moment, and they have a heritage and history there, so that's great. And Street Triples, fantastic. Daytonas, I'm not sure what's happening with the Daytona, but surely it won't be left languishing, because that's a bike that they just did so well. Okay, so that's that one. We're nearly there. Second from last issue. Only one thing to pull out here, and that's this. This is, talking of Triumph and retros, this is the Triumph Bobber. They did a one of their group reviews and struggled a little bit to find things to compare it with. The reason I point this out, by the way, is that the Bobber is a bike that I'm currently borrowing from Triumph, even though I'm currently showing the Street Cup ones tucked in my garage. Is this very beast, well, not this very one, but a Triumph Bobber. So stay tuned next week for the first videos of that coming up. And it is quite a bike, I have to say. But it's sort of in a class of its own. It's difficult to find competitors, other than maybe the smaller Harley. They've also compared it with an Indian Scout and also the mighty Ducati X Diavel S, which is a bike costing twice as much. That's not really a fair comparison. But in terms of their shootout, the Diavel came first, which isn't a surprise, it's twice the price of the others, and then the Bobber came second, so that's great news for Triumph. Anyway, so that was the only story actually that I picked out of that one. And then last but not least, we come to this week's edition. A few things here caught my eye. First one, the Yamaha R6, the new version with the new bodywork, makes it look a bit like the R1. It looks really great, but it's basically still the same bike as it used to be, with the same engine and geometry and so on, but it's just been Euro 4. If that makes sense. I recently saw the 44 Teeth review of this as well. They were on a track in Spain. I assume it's the same launch as MCN were at. And they came to largely the same conclusion that sadly, the Euro 4 stuff has rendered the bike a little bit breathless, which is a real shame because I rode the old bike last month and thoroughly enjoyed it. It was just amazing. And I've been promised a ride on this new one as soon as they become available in dealers. So looking forward to doing that because I'll be doing more of a sort of a real world review rather than just thrashing it around a track. And I doubt, you know, with my insensitive posterior, whether I'll tell the difference between this and the old one, I don't know, we'll see. But really looking forward to having a go on it. I love the old bike. I imagine I'm going to love the new bike as well, even though these initial reviews haven't been that glowing, it has to be said. Okay, oh yeah, this is quite interesting. This is the Ducati Monster, the 797, a bike that I'm actually not that keen on, to be fair. But the reason why I highlighted this is because they've just brought out this 2017 model, and they've reintroduced an air-cooled engine, which I just think is interesting because, you know, everybody's going water-cooled these days, aren't they? But Ducati have decided that the character of the Monster is such that it should really have an air-cooled motor. So they've put in the motor out of the scrambler to hopefully appeal to its loyal fan base. So just interesting that they've made that what could be seen as a retro step, but I think it's probably quite a shrewd move. We'll see how sales go. Okay, and then finally for this month's review, aha! This is what I've got on the screen here. The Street Triple RX has been, or RS rather, I should say, they've pitted it up against the Kawasaki Z900, which is obviously one of its main competitors. The Z900 has done well in previous MCN reviews. In this one, I'm delighted to say actually that the RS trounced it. Well, it didn't trounce it, but they've said that the RS is the better bike. They may be biased because they're British, of course, I don't know. But really, really looking forward to riding the new Street Triple. Lots of people have asked me when I'm going to do it. I'm hoping to get a long-term loaner from Triumph so I can really get to know the bike. As somebody who's owned a Street Triple for 5 years now, I feel I know the particular model pretty well, so should be able to really see what the difference is on the RS. So can't wait to do that. Haven't got a date yet, but as soon as I get the bike, I shall be bringing you some videos of it. Okay, that's it for my news review this month. Hope that's been of interest. Look forward to speaking to you next time. Until then, this has been the Missing Them Fly. Cheerio.